Robert, talk me through the experience that the audience is going to get at this performance, because it's not just going to be the music they're experiencing, is it?
No, it's not. This project was conceived by the Houston Symphony a few years back, incorporating footage from some of the space missions originating out of NASA, which is in Houston. So it was a nice partnership between the symphony and the space agency. They had the very interesting idea of taking footage of the planets themselves and putting it up with the accompaniment to Holst's depiction of these same planets. And we go through the whole solar system, with the exception of the Earth, because we're on the Earth. We'll see in succession Mars and Mercury and Neptune and all the planets, with the exception of Pluto, which wasn't discovered yet at the time of the writing of the planets, which had its premiere right at the end of World War I. So what we'll see is this beautiful footage, and you'll hear the music, and it goes in sequence. So it will say Mars, and then we'll play Mars, and it will say Venus, and then we'll play Venus. For all of the movements of the planets. And I was really quite impressed with the effect that the combination of this film and this music has.
What are the challenges of performing and indeed conducting the planets? Because you've got a huge orchestra, for starters, haven't you?
It's enormous. It's one of the biggest orchestras. It's up around 90-some players. And it's beautifully orchestrated. I mean, he uses all of those instruments exquisitely. And it's basically marshaling these forces to really deliver the effect of Holst's compositions. And they're very specific. The most popular ones, I think, what the audience will know are Mars and Jupiter. That has the big tunes in it. And Mars has the big sort of militaristic fanfares and very characteristic five in a bar rhythm that has been borrowed, shall we say, by numerous film composers in the best sort of way. I mean, lots of film composers have taken that as their inspiration and made something really, really great out of
it. Well, the war theme works in that sense, doesn't it?
Wonderfully, wonderfully. So whenever you have a threatening, you know, enemy force, this is a wonderful, wonderful thing to be hearing. So the challenge, it's a 50-minute piece. It's really big, and it ends with this absolutely magical choir of women's voices, like sirens. We travel right through the solar system, and we get to the very edge of Neptune, the last planet. In those days, like I said, Pluto wasn't discovered yet. And we're just about to leave the solar system and go into infinity, and we begin to hear voices. Like you could imagine if you had been traveling through the solar system, you're hearing voices, and it's just a stroke of genius. I mean, it's one of the things that after a very long orchestral performance just lifts it and gives it absolutely an exquisite ending.
You mentioned the fact that the audience is most likely to be familiar with Mars and obviously the tunes of Jupiter. Mm-hmm. Does that add an extra challenge for the performers, the conductor, the orchestra, because the audience knows that bit so well and they may be expecting something different or a new interpretation of it? How do you approach that?
It's not so much that. It's just the recognition factor is so strong that you don't want that to be the only thing they remember. Like, there's the tune I know and I don't know this other stuff, but I don't think that's going to be a problem because it gives such impetus to the performance when they get something they recognize, that something they hold on to, it's a marker for them. And then the other things that they may not know so well, it's the music is just as exquisite. I would encourage everyone to, look forward to those unknown bits too.
It also strikes me that it's an interesting experience for you because you're standing there looking out across the orchestra as you would normally do, but suddenly above the orchestra, you're not going to be distracted by these images, are you?
No. Well, the popularity of film and music nowadays is huge. I've done quite a few concerts like this where you play live music to film. And it's a really curious sensation, because I've done a live performance of 2001, and I've done other things, you know, some bits of Rodgers and Hammerstein music and things like that. But the film is somehow enlivened, you know, by the live music. And as a conductor, you begin to know, you know, if there's any hit points, as we say, where the music and the film must coordinate. You work on that, and then you find yourself cueing the film like you'd cue an opera singer. And then you find the film kind of reacting to you, and you go, no, this has gone into a new dimension now. And it becomes a very plastic, in the sense it's a very flexible experience. I don't find it distracting at all. You do need to get used to it, but once you get used to it, it's a very sort of generous medium to work with.
And all this is traveling the country. It coincides, of course, with the 70th anniversary of the orchestra.
Of the Royal Philharmonic, yes.
So it's an exciting time.
It's a wonderful time. I'm really, really pleased to be involved with it. I've worked with the RPO, well, for many, many years. But I'm really happy to be doing this tour. And we're going right the length and breadth of the country, from Edinburgh right down to Bristol. And it's going to be wonderful.